At the end of the 19th century, agriculture had become very dependent on an ever-dwindling supply of saltpeter from South America. Nitrogen is a limiting factor for crop productivity in many soils, and nitrate from guano and saltpeter was for a long time the only source of nitrogen in fertilizers. Chemists around the world were looking for a way to turn atmospheric nitrogen into nitrate or ammonia that can later be oxidized to nitrate. Just before the First World War, Fritz Haber succeeded in developing a process where nitrogen and hydrogen gas were brought together at high temperature and, crucially, a catalyst to produce ammonia. A version of this process is still the main way in which nitrogen fertilizer is produced and has boosted agricultural productivity immensely. The reaction is chemically extremely slow, and the catalyst is crucial to make it happen at a useful rate. In the industrial setting, that catalyst is a form of specially treated iron. Interestingly, many free-living and symbiotic bacteria can achieve the same thing, without high temperature and without high pressure, although it still costs a lot of energy. Biological nitrogen fixation happens with one of nature's own catalysts, an enzyme called nitrogenase. In this video, we will try and understand what enzymes are and how they accelerate chemical reactions. So, what are enzymes? Most enzymes by far are proteins, although a small number of important ones are RNA molecules. The 3D structure of enzymes has evolved to provide an active site, that is, a docking surface or a binding pocket, to bind one or several substrates, and then to catalytically convert those substrates to products. Many enzymes are made from a single polypeptide chain, others have two or more subunits, that is, two or more separate polypeptide chains. Sometimes this is because the reaction is complicated and several substrates need to be held in place. Sometimes having more than one subunit allows for more precise control of enzyme activity. Enzymes have a number of important properties that explain why they are central to biochemistry. First, enzymes are catalysts. That means they bring a chemical reaction to its equilibrium faster, in fact, way, way faster, but they don't change where the equilibrium lies. Also, we only call something a catalyst, or enzyme for that matter, if it is itself unchanged in the reaction. It should not be used up. As an example, hydrogen peroxide spontaneously dissociates into water and oxygen. After an infinite amount of time, in a closed system, nearly all of the hydrogen peroxide will dissociate. But this is quite a slow process, and we can keep bottles of hydrogen peroxide in the lab safely. They only very gradually build up pressure from the oxygen produced. If we add a catalyst, we don't change where that equilibrium lies, but we can get there much faster. A chemist would say we don't change the thermodynamics of the overall system, but we do change the kinetics. The rate of reaction is sped up. Enzymes can speed up the rate of reaction by a factor of between several thousand and millions of billions of times. For the specific example above, the enzyme catalase accelerates the reaction by a factor of about 3 billion. That's far from the most impressive acceleration, but this is only because the reaction does happen spontaneously at some rate. Most reactions catalyzed by enzymes practically do not happen spontaneously at all. Compared with chemistry in the test tube, enzymes have further properties that are pretty amazing. The majority of enzymes are quite particular in what substrates they accept, so they only feed specific reactants into a process. Enzymes are always stereospecific. From a chemical point of view, two enantiomers, two mirror images of one molecule, behave exactly in the same way. So spontaneous reactions of chiral molecules happen at the same rate, and if an achiral molecule becomes chiral in a spontaneous reaction, both stereoisomers are formed. For example, in solution, glucose can spontaneously switch back and forth between the open-chain aldehyde form and either one of the two hemiacetal ring forms, the alpha or beta anomer. If you started with pure alpha glucopyranose in solution, once it opened up to the open-chain aldehyde form, it would not specifically go back to the alpha anomer, but a mixture of alpha and beta. In contrast, in vivo, enzymes make sure that only the correct stereoisomer is used for any one purpose. Here, for example, in the biosynthesis of cellulose, glucose is only incorporated in the beta form. And finally, enzymes have exquisite reaction specificity. That means that there are no byproducts. The yields of the correct product is essentially 100%. This is actually a big difference from organic chemistry in the lab or in the factory, because chemists are forever fretting over yields and specificity and byproducts of reaction. Enzymes don't give us that problem. So how do enzymes accelerate a chemical reaction? As we're going to see, enzymes lower the activation energy of the reaction. This diagram is a so-called energy diagram, where the x-axis represents the reaction coordinate, that is, the progress from substrates to products, and the y-axis represents the overall energy, more specifically, the Gibbs free energy, or G, of the molecules at any one time. In this case, the products have a lower free energy than the substrates. That means that once a reversible reaction has reached equilibrium, there will be more products than substrate. We say the reaction is favored, energetically favored. It progresses towards product formation, and the net change in free energy, delta G, is negative. That is, energy is released as opposed to a net input of energy. That is what we would need to go in the opposite direction to make S from P. The important thing here is that enzymes do not and cannot affect the net free energy change of a reaction. Delta G reflects the ratio of substrate to product at equilibrium, and if negative, formation of product is energetically favored. What is affected is the energy barrier between the start and the end of a reaction. TS here means the transition state of the reaction. An uneasy in-between state that is only reached by an input of energy. For an uncatalyzed reaction, that energy barrier, the activation energy, or delta G double dagger, can be quite large. And this is where enzymes come in. The activation energy determines the kinetics of the reaction, or the reaction rate. A high activation energy means that the reaction will progress to equilibrium much more slowly than one with a low activation energy. Enzymes can reduce that energy barrier and so speed up the reaction by providing an alternative reaction pathway with a lower activation energy. The generic pathway of the enzymatic conversion of a single substrate is given here. Substrate binding to the enzyme gives us the enzyme substrate complex, ES. Catalysis converts the substrate then to product, which is eventually released. If you plot this scheme in the energy diagram, we see that the pathway has become a little more complicated, but crucially, the energy barrier between enzyme-bound substrate and enzyme-bound product, ES to EP, is much lower than the original uncatalyzed reaction. This is the essence of catalysis. By providing an alternative reaction pathway with lower activation energy, the rate of the reaction, its kinetics, is sped up considerably. The high specificity of enzymes had led scientists originally to assume that spatially enzyme and substrate fit together like lock and key. It has turned out that that is not actually the case. There are two important ways in which a three-dimensional fit is achieved that are perhaps not intuitively obvious. First, most enzymes adjust their conformation in minor or not so minor ways only after a substrate has bound. This so-called induced fit means that the active site fits the substrate better only after binding. Second, the active site, the pocket to which a substrate binds, actually matches the transition state better than the original substrate. By providing better complementarity and better non-covalent interactions, the awkward transition state is stabilized and the energetic barrier between substrates and the transition state is lowered. Finally, for reactions with more than one substrate, the ability of enzymes to bring all of them into close proximity and in exactly the right orientation also favors the formation of the correct products. Compared with accidentally bumping into each other in solution, as it would in an uncatalyzed reaction, an enzyme can increase the effective concentration of the reacting groups. To help with binding and conversion of substrate molecules, the amino acid residues of the active site of enzymes contribute to binding by non-covalent interactions as well as catalysis. The latter can happen in a number of ways. Some side chains are good proton donors or acceptors, for example in the figure below, lysine as proton acceptor and glutamic acid as proton donor are essential for this enzyme called enolase. Some active site residues can transiently form covalent bonds with the substrate. And finally, many enzymes have metal ions in their active site, such as magnesium in the figure below, and these are held in place, depending on the metal, with active site glutamate and aspartate residues, or for heavy metals, cysteine and histidine. The side chains of the enzyme's own amino acids can't always do everything by themselves and need cofactors. These come in a variety of flavors. Some enzymes need metal ions, either as a loosely bound activator ion or as a tightly bound metal ions in metalloenzymes. Many enzymes need coenzymes, small molecules that transiently carry atoms, like hydrogen, or functional groups, like phosphate. These are often split into co-substrates like ATP or coenzyme A that are loosely bound and need recycling by a different enzyme, and prosthetic groups that stay in situ and are tightly bound to the enzyme. Many of the vitamins we need are the source of these coenzymes. Now you know why we need them.